Hello and welcome to the 53rd Radical Poetry Reading. I'm Malva Kajali, Special Projects Associate here at The Rail, and today I have the pleasure of welcoming artist and writer and all-around good man to be in fellowship with, Bernardo Wade, who has lovingly curated a fantastic lineup of poets and readers for us today, featuring Ross Gay, Diannely Antigua, Taylor Johnson, and Elle Williams. We've started out all of our events here with two important acknowledgments. The first is that here in New York, we're on Lenape Hoking, the unceded land and waters of the Wappinger, Canarsie, Munsee, and Lenni Lenape people of the Delaware Nation and the Shinnecock Indian Nation. The second is an acknowledgement that Black Lives Matter. And I think it's worth taking a moment to remember that the heart of both of these acknowledgements is a commitment to the liberation of the oppressed and ongoing solidarity for all those who struggle for freedom, in recognition that when it comes to our liberation, our histories never unfold in isolation. That thought coming from the fabulous Angela Davis. And in that spirit, I encourage you all to check out the chat, where in just a moment, I'll drop a living document of resources and actions that we've been putting together behind the scenes at The Rail. But without further ado, we'll get right into it. It's my honor to welcome our wonderful curator of this afternoon. Like so many of our icons and our follies, Bernardo Wade is from New Orleans, Louisiana. He's an associate editor of Indiana Review, a Watering Hole Fellow, and he moonlights as an equity and justice advocate. He has work published in or forthcoming in Crazy Horse, Black Warrior Review, Hayden's Ferry Review, New Orleans Review, Southern Humanities Review, a lot of reviews, Salt Hilt Journal, Yamahasi, the Minnesota Review, and many others. He was last seen on The Rail just a few weeks ago, closing out one of our programs with a number of ekphrastic poems that I believe he'll be sharing from today. So without further ado, Bernardo, take it away.
Well, what's up? Thank you. Thank you, Malvika, for letting us throw this together kind of quickly, but I think, you know, beautifully. I'm going to, the theme is joy and pain, and I don't really have too much like philosophical poetic reasoning behind that, but I do want to share something just to kind of get the vibe right before we get started. This is all I was really thinking of. Actually, no, because, you know, we got Ross, and Ross is kind of like on that the spectrum of joy. Plus, I know he'd been kind of writing some things on that. And then we got Diannely, who, you know, she likes, she you know, a proclaimed sad poet. And so, and so we got, you know, we got Elle and Taylor. Like, we're all kind of in the spectrum in between that, which probably every human is, but, you know, like, yeah. And then I thought about this little jam that I'm gonna play that I just really. Thank you.
like sunshine. Sometimes devotion and sometimes deceit. The ones that you care for.
Oh, I was supposed to fade out. I'm gonna get better at that. Don't worry. yeah, so we might just play that. That might be the thing that bind, you know, that song is kind of like the you know, the elasticity of something between that binds us all that are here today, besides, you know, a text message like, will you please do this? You know. I'll talk about, you know, these beautiful poets as I intro them. I mean, I'm going to start with just a few, you know, really it's easy to be a curator, I think, just because you just have to find people that, you know, that you love their work. Like you dig what they do almost more than, you know, more than your own, you know what I'm saying? And you like, you know, it really becomes this kind of like, yeah, this like blessing. I would say it's a blessing because you're like, oh wow, like I get to ask someone that I look up to in a way to do a thing, you know. All right, but I'm gonna read this first poem, then we're gonna do a couple of frastic joints. This poem about my father in New Orleans. I'm just gonna get into it. A little pain here, a little joy too. This is called Some Awful Word. Halfway through an exhale that begins to smooth out the deep lines of worry on his forehead, my father ashes his joint. I don't feel nervous, but my left leg is restless again. He tells me, stop shaking. Thinks it makes me look soft. Reveals to the world too much of me. On Sundays, here for the game means we study one another. I almost flinch when he mutters, motherfucker. After a field goal in the third quarter, he has a distant look that seems to focus out the window, but really, he's somewhere else. Me and Olin, we used to sell cold drinks and shit for the Saints games, you know, when they was at Tulane Stadium. No nets behind the goal, and after the kicks, people will be fighting over the ball. One time, after an extra point, Olin jumped all the way up and snatched that ball like a god, smiling all the way down. But them, they took that ball. They was men. We, he says, we was just boys. Then he gets up, throws his right fist in the air and cheers. Mahomes scores a miracle touchdown. And I notice my leg going again. Since I was a child, he's taught me to pull for the black quarterback because, like us, he's not supposed to win, not without a smile or without a God's help. He can't stand it when they say, thank you. And the commentators call them some awful word like humble. Code for a Negro they can feel safe around. One they might take from again. He turns off the post game, sparing us Mahomes' humble testimony, and tells me again to stop shaking my leg. I thank him. Not for being a man I don't feel safe around, but for remembering the child who never heard, you're welcome. All right, and I got two little ephrastic joints. The first one, these are, these are based on Dawood Bey's photography. I'm just gonna get into it. A young man resting on an exercise bike, Amityville, New York, 1988, photographed by Dawube. It's like the young man readies to spread wings, elbows splayed on bars, obsidian shoulders sleek from the sky's gleam. His eyes, heavy with quiet ease, stare into the lens. A palpable need bites back a dissenting smile. Muscle memories arrest his body, filling the scene. How did Bay ask him to act natural? To pose his swaggered smirk for the sufferable stillness of his small machine? Captured in the shadow and light as the space between expression and black flight. To pedal nowhere is to fiend the act of flying. Amityville, a great migration, so maybe those are wings. The image is a discourse, an obliteration of causality. Notice how his right fist covets something. His forearm is flexed. His left hand seems to find the right, fingers spread like those of a mother who speaks, calm down, with touch. Whatever he grips, he holds it like at any moment he'll let it go and glide away from frame into dream. The boy has a wristwatch, but the camera devours the temporal. The face of his timepiece becomes a grimace, 300 years of waiting on the corner of idolatry. Who's looking? Bay and the young man survive an afternoon, an arm's length. All right, this is my last one. And then we can get to the real, these beautiful poets y'all came to see. All right. A woman and a child in the doorway, Harlem, 1975, photographed by Dawube. Don't look into the eyes of that baby for too long. She's made of mirrors. She takes in your questions, chews them, then calls it photography. I warned you. She's got you in sight. I've watched her turn a man inside the language of cower. He left tongueless with a look. She points down the dark hall, but knows you're not prepared. Too many shadows. Her mama more gently says, come on. I know you're not scared. Notice her right foot, halfway in the shadow and halfway in the light, like it readies to smash something dead beneath its soul, maybe, where the baby thinks you belong. Death isn't a dark tunnel, and the light bulb at the end of the hallway is not a metaphor for heaven. Let's start over. Look into her eyes. Now breathe. As she stares into something beneath you, asks, do I disappear? When you close your eyes, her mother holds her high on her hip, curls her hand around her little fingers because someone must, because the image won't. People say God is light. Maybe that's how the baby sees it. She says, that little piece of bright is ours. All right. I'm just gonna introduce. I think we're gonna start with. Oh, I forgot that we got an order. We're gonna start with Diannely, right? Okay.
You did so good, you lost your place. You sent us all, so we lost our place too.
You know, we have a I have a complex relationship with time. So, no. So Diannely is going to go up first. Really, I just got to pick the people that I work with on poems. And Diannely and I have been talking about poems, thinking about poems of late. I admire her work, and I admire the notes that, just the conversations that we've had, I've been fortunate because, everyone in this reading, I wouldn't be, some more recent than others, but I wouldn't be on this journey in the same way without them. So this is kind of a selfish reading in that respect. This is my poetry cipher. I'm just gonna introduce Diannely Antigua.
Thank you, Bernardo. Thank you, Malvika, and the readers, Ross, L, Taylor. I'm just so excited to be here. And when I was picking poems today, thinking about joy and pain, I was having a harder time picking poems that had a little bit of joy. I am a self-proclaimed sad poet, sad bitch, all of those things. But I have been trying to add a little bit more joy in my poetry, trying to harness a little bit of that Ross Gay, because who doesn't, want to harness Ross Gay? Instead of what would Jesus do, it's what would Ross Gay do? No lie, that's my new mantra. And so September is both, or at least part of September is Latinx Heritage Month, and that also goes into some of October. And then September is also Suicide Prevention Awareness Month. And both of those things are near and dear to my heart as both a survivor and a Latina. So I, wanted to just, both celebrate and also remember the joy and the pain that people in my life, and also that I have survived and lived. So it's just an honor to be sharing this work with you today. I'm going to be reading some poems from my book, Ugly Music, and then I'm going to be reading, two short poems that I wrote this past year. This first poem is Something Dies in Me Every Month. Today, I screenshot a picture of an internet baby who looks like my ex, sleeping, mouth open, little fist above his head. And it's a tiny poison in my eggs. How we can be allergic to whatever we want, a week in bruises, or when I said sorry to my face, like the time I stopped breathing. And a man called me a name, something less than animal, but more than stone. And all I can say is, I'm trying to be decent. I'm trying to believe in the therapy of sleeping rooms, of sugar on my wrists. Yesterday, I bought fried chicken and orange juice for a homeless man on 6th. To make myself needed. And the act conjured a weirdness in me, like wanting to have his baby. And I don't want to be told about the bitches inside me that want out. And want the pleasure of watching my body do things without permission. Or maybe I have an awkward courage. Maybe it's that I've hugged too many grocery bags on walks home and felt the lonely power of feeding myself, or how the moon, it appears even in the morning, a pale thing drowned in blue sky. I also remembered the reason why I chose that poem was because the full moon over the past few days has just been fucking gorgeous, and it just left this ache in my heart. And I was driving home from my ballroom dance class yesterday. That's another thing, I'm trying to bring in some joy. And I was just so distracted on the highway looking at the moon. It was so gorgeous. All right, this next poem is diary entry number 4, Huzzle. And within my book, there are a lot of diary entry poems, and all of the diary entry poems are actually collage poems that I wrote using my old journal that I've written in since I was 9. So it just kind of is a way for me to reclaim these old stories, retell them, and allow that little girl who I was to tell her story too. And I also meant to say before I started reading, content warning for all of my poems deal with suicidal ideation, suicide, and sexuality. So just please take care of yourself if need be, if you need to step away. Diary entry number 4, Huzzle. Then I did something I didn't think I could do. Dear God, I thought about suicide, then my algebra homework, then maybe something else godly, how I was going to fast and pray for a language to explain last Wednesday. I'm no God, but I'm trying to dust off the ashes of the change. I got my period and I feel less godlike, an unclean romance in my body, how I cupped my hands to catch whatever came. Little bit of God's blood escaping my vagina, or how the idea of cutting a wrist might lead to more goddess. Dr. Rosenblum says, I need a counselor, says I am officially broken, and that I will pick up a knife to cut the God spell out of me. I tell him there's a mouth in my underwear wadded with tissue. It sings beautiful things when it's touched. It sings, oh God. So this next poem I wrote in a workshop this past summer. And it's a sonnet, and I feel like it's been just like a wild journey trying to write poems this past summer, this past year. So I was just happy that I was able to produce anything, and that was even actually in a form. 100 and then none. Last night, a man was yelling in the parking lot as I walked to my car. I don't know what he said, but it sounded like my name. Like my stepfather, when he called me 4 Christmases ago from an unknown number, said he loved me like a daughter, as if he'd never touched me like a lover. I was 9. He wasn't asleep, but pretending. His large, hairy arms locked around my frame, my body, accustomed only to my mother's hairless arms. In those early years of begging to be so close to my creator. Yesterday, the man I'm seeing used the words love and you in the same sentence. I can tell summer is coming because I am afraid. There are pills. Will I be a good mother? I can't forgive her soft harm. In my family, the women believe in powder under the arms, under the breasts. Today, I hold 3 pills in my palm where I once held more than 100 and then none at all. This next poem also includes my mother. And my mom, she's so sweet. She lets me write about her all the time. And she says that now that she's in all my poems, that she's now famous. So she's very happy. Okay. We never stop talking about our mothers, Renee and I. Hers in the urn by her desk and mine. Alive in an apartment 40 minutes from here. Probably watching a telenovela or frying plantains, texting me goodnight, Renee's mother isn't really in the urn, but she's in the blue wall and the beach landscape painting, the dog barking at the unexpected, the jingle of her silver bracelets. We are all carrying our mothers, and we are all better daughters with the dead. She tells me I am wise, and all I can think about are the moments of my unwiseness, driving and sipping margaritas from a water bottle, the bruise on my arm, and taking him back. Her husband is away at the family cabin, and she is glad for the space. My husband doesn't exist, and I am sad for the space I make my home in. I buy sunflowers and goat cheese and throw a dinner party for the ghosts. I don't know Renee's mother's name to send a proper invitation. I don't know the names of the women in my family past my great-grandmother. How will I call upon them when it's time? Will I call them Mary or Venus or Yemaya? I've yet to burn the Palo Santo and the sage. I want to leave behind a legacy of light. I want to leave someone better. And I have this last one for you, just a short one. Thank you all so much for being here. Thank you all for giving me this opportunity to share my work. I feel very, very grateful. Anniversary. Outside, an abandoned mattress sags with rain, and the driveway turns all sludge. When I remember, I could have died 8 years ago in a bed smaller than the one I share with a new lover, who just this morning found another gray hair in my afro. And before resettling the wiry curl with the others, kissed the speckle on my forehead. I admit, I don't know a love that doesn't destroy. Last night, while we slept, a mouse drowned in the rice pot I left soaking in the sink. I tried to make a metaphor out of this, the way he took the mouse to the edge of the lake in the yard and released it to a deeper grave. It was an anniversary, just my lover taking a dead thing away, taking it somewhere I couldn't see. Thank you so much, y'all.
Wow. You know, there's that the poem with the ghost, it did remind me that, you know, when we read poems at a reading, we're not reading just for the people that are present, but also for the people that can't be present. And so thank you for reminding us of that. It's not, we're not the only things here. All right, I'm gonna do a little palate cleanser for those poems that are still humming through us.
Give you so much pain, oh, but it's all right.
All right. So our first guest, our second guest, Taylor Johnson, is a poet. Nah, we're not gonna do that. Yo, for real though, Taylor is my people. the first time we got together, we took a walk in Audubon Park in New Orleans, and we both realized we didn't quite understand Twitter. I think it's a thing. It's a thing I think we're still grappling with. No, again, understand Twitter, Twitter, L, Twitter, the whole thing, the whole institution. No, we just from Jump Street, we just hit it off, and we've been thick ever since, for real. Like, not only are there poems like crazy, if y'all haven't read Inheritance, y'all sleep. But they good people, and that's more important, like, honestly. And again, they part of the cipher. Taylor is that person in the cipher that, like, will let me know if that shit ain't ready, you know, like. But I love them for it, and I love them for doing this for us. So with no further, how do you say that, ado, Taylor Johnson.
Okay, there we go. It works now. So I was having Wi-Fi issues. Bernardo, you know I love you, man. Hope you can hear me. Can you hear me? You can hear me? Okay, bet. Thank you for inviting me. Thank you, Diannely, Ross, L, Mavka, for organizing all this. Yeah, I'm just going to read from Inheritance.
Can y'all hear? I can't hear.
You can't hear. Can you hear Bernardo?
I can't hear Taylor.
You can hear?
I can hear.
Oh, okay, cool.
If you can't hear, say something.
I know I was having Wi-Fi issues, so.
Okay, everyone can hear you.
Okay. Cool. Since I put that internet service, I'm thinking more about the transitive properties in books. The words, the palimpsest of images accruing in my brain, but more immediately, the book in my hand, the cover worn at one end from sweat and gripping it when it comes close. Close as in when I stood up, let one deep exhale when I came to the lines of all fearless happiness from which reaches my life I sing and find it underlined by a beloved stranger. It's like turning the record over, knowing you're hearing what I'm hearing, easing up on the edge of the chair. It's like we're holding hands now at the edge of a white silence from which we ought to make a music of our being here, of being moved, wherein our music complements and holds close each other's sound in the wet room of the tree I met you in. Nothing is said about the water or the fearless trees angled toward and against the light that did fall on me, made much of me, light that sings through me, so I'm singing. Lincoln Town Car. My grandfather would spell certain words so that the dog couldn't comprehend. O-U-T-F-O-O-D, that dog, that little bear fighter ran into the road one day, buried in the yard now. And the next dog, he waited in the back room for my grandmother to return, heavy-footed from around the corner. And when she didn't return, he remained there, unreachable as language. Something was wrong if we left the country, fluid around the heart, not enough movement, syrup for blood. Leaving meant taking showers and my grandfather fixing my grandmother's hair. All of us clean-shirted in the front seat of the Lincoln Town Car. We shared a humid thought, pressed as we were against the maroon leather, six-legged in the front seat. Before us, the highway unraveled, sorghum and corn and soy collapsing as the wind fell, listening for light. I listen for the muscadine swelling in the ditches on the waterlogged sides of the highway. I listen to the quiet narrow as we enter the city. I love the language my grandparents spoke, saying nothing, holding both my hands. Was the pines that set off sound in them. My grandmother stared out the windshield and into the hills, saying, "That man, that man." My grandfather shifted in his seat at the wheel, practicing owning something. I had a feeling that I was the last let into the kingdom of their distance. Something was owed. Neither side would spell it out. I counted the fallen pines as the car dipped through the hills in the tide water, lonely as a dog with the whole world inside. I counted the pines and put my voice inside them. I was gonna read something new I wrote, Bernardo, but I'm still confused about where to start the poem. So I'm just gonna keep reading from this book. And then I'll read something that's, I guess, kind of newer. I forget about money watching the clouds over 8th and Ingraham. The clouds, a rhubarb colored ship in the sky. To my right, it all grays out. The bats emerging now from the chimneys. The bats listening for the cicada's echo. Echo is a way to create space, is a metaphor for time. Time for the cop to move along. I think watching the cop watch me from my porch, fuck 12, the robin on the wire vine, the wire eye competing with the bats for cicadas, the robin competing reds with the sky a money for the cicadas, a way to make space, time. The cicadas sounding out the future through repetition. A friend says to spend nothing is to keep flexibility in your hands, to keep your youth. Money, the sound of decay. Money, the repetition of waste. Black existential exegesis. This engine and cog business is with doubt. I want nothing we're owed from the ship gig, thence the land whereon modern sound weaned off our cowrie and cachet aged conjure. Land whereon our woe is chic and wanted. Shout out to every nigga cajoled into winging it in a crowd, crowing about being the hewer and the hewer's subject. Oh, my aching chore choir do upon our ochre echo throughout this land, this cadence gag, our eco, ego greeted upon and caged. Grace is our odd crowd which encores green and geodes. Shout out to every nigga dodging age by ignoring human genre fiction gore. Ergo, we're nowhere, reneging on being owned and renewed, weighing nothing like race. Shout out to every nigga eroding off the edge of something else gossamering in the air. Art movie. Red is a secret in the trees. The train passes through the trees in Alabama. Red earth, red earth. The winter light consumes the field. The light silvers, the light relieves. The light thrown as dust upon the field I put my ear in. I crack an egg and a saxophone that tells on me, yells at me, comes out. No yolk. The train hollers to stop. The train stops, still loads new passengers, but the conductor won't let me get off and kiss you. You know that's what I haunted to do. The stage is the window circle between us, the emergency exit door. I keep you in my ear and give you how I'm doing and what I want to eat where I'm not on a train. You and your white boots. You tell me what else could come out of an egg. Women all the way down, holding waist. The train is a place going by. Strictly passing through. I touch a stranger's wrist going back to my seat. The whole train becomes a garment I put on. I touch indiscriminately. I can't stay, I tell the dog waving from your convertible. None of the windows open. I held your gaze until I couldn't. In the previous scene, I took you to the slip until we were shining tunnels for sound. I took your sound for my name, never asked what I called myself. I'll just read one more. That's not in my book, Inheritance. Okay, thank you again, Bernardo. Sounded through. From forever in the glade and unendingly so, the animal choir sings my grandfather to forever. Forever is the sound of a seed opening, and so opens his body, my grandfather given back from attenuated beingness, the gray of which slips off as a seed from my finger slips into belonging. He was just turning a corner, just one foot following beside the other, but a bit behind, as I would follow him a bit behind, one thumb in his hammer loop, our boots ringed in dew. I danced in his shadow and fit my antlers on his head. Our language was twin green and nothing. He sang it from his elk body when he died. Thank you.
Thank you. God. That last one was nice. That Lincoln Town Car gave me every time, though. That's beautiful. Beautiful. Whew. All right, we got to move on. This the palate cleanser. Just a little bit. We just need a little bit. I didn't even share it. Okay. I hope y'all heard that. We got my man's Mr. L. Williams III, AKA gorgeous poet, best looking on Zoom, AKA honored dinner guest, AKA smoke cigars on the port, AKA 3 o'clock games of R&B game, AKA puts up with me almost on a daily. And I love him for it. Now, L's easily, you know, one of the most important people. Again, the more that I'm thinking about this reading, that the poem's cool, but like, this is about people. Honestly, like, these are important people in my life, and that's what poems are. So, you know, if you don't believe that, I don't know, go argue with your mama about it. I don't know. So L, you know, we go to school together, we laugh together, we cry together, we know all the joys and pains and of this, you know, this life that we mirror back and forth, you know, in this kind of daily grind that we share. And I don't know how I'd do it without you. And I just want to let you know I appreciate you. And I'm really happy that you could be here. That's it. L. Williams.
Thank you, Bernardo, so much. Let me see some. Just pin myself. Thank you, Bernardo, for curating this. Diannely, beautiful. Taylor, beautiful. Malvika, thank you so much. Ross, can't wait, as always, to hear you read. I just feel blessed to be here. Thank you for everyone who's here right now. I'm going to be reading poems about my grandmother and great-grandmother, working through a lot of grief and joy and pain. Bernardo knows and Ross knows I'm a big R&B soul music head. So this is a great thing for me. also, I was cracking up with Taylor about your tofu dog at the cookout. okay. The wallet. Upon her death, I obtained my grandmother's wallet. Snatched it off the dining room table at an idle point during the family meeting. Having fetched it many times, I was a grandson running errands. What grandma called her legs. Be my legs for me today, she'd say. And so I put the wallet with other relics. My mother's journal papers deemed meaningful wedding photos and photos of cousins we hadn't seen in years. The wallet, a trinket that meant something and nothing at once. In the world of the past, where things entered through grief, exited through longing. One night I heard the wallet from the closet, or was it my grandmother's voice etched into memory? Be my legs for me today, she'd say, or I was dreaming. Driving, running in and out of the drugstore, the grocery store, the hardware store, and lastly, White Castle. I woke up in exhaust. I woke up in sadness. I woke up and walked in the blind black like a mad mummy, pushing my way to the closet. I combed through the world of the past, feeling for the thick jacket leather, hooking a finger in its fold. The wallet and I, my grandmother and I, the wallet and I rested in the dimness of night. Rubbing along its ridges, I imagined her thick, healthy nails scarring the skin. As she mined her purse, looking for it, digging for it like the promise of prize. The green body laid there the length of a forearm fat with photos, records, bills, cards, ads for bingo, my mother's ID, great-grandfather's driver's license. It lied there so stiff and still, its flat buttoned, folding down like a chin. This next one is a real short one. It's called No, I Do Not Know. No, I do not know how to make pie crust from scratch. Only the filling, only the sweet potatoes boiled and peeled with a stick of butter softening into the mash. A pinch of salt. I add the sugar and I add the sugar and I listen for a voice saying enough. Milk, enough. Two eggs, white as ever, cracked and glistening over the mix, stirred, nutmeg, cinnamon. I am careful with the vanilla and other things I was informed not to mention. No, I do not know how to make pie crust from scratch. My great grandmother taught me this recipe from a frozen crust. Something easily accessible and readily available, as if at some point I too will be responsible for the whole spread or the whole house. So this next one I'm gonna read is, I have two drafts and I could not find a draft with the punctuation. So I'm going to try my best to breathe, because this one, the one I printed out, does not have punctuation. So this is What Is It They Say? Columbia, Missouri, 2011. The chorus of cicadas loudly singing and sexing was near the end of its journey when my 05 Nissan Altima concluded it too had accomplished what it was put on earth to do. the engine sluggish and knocking to the rhythm of a slow crank. I told the symptoms to a mechanic who told me that it was the work of a busted catalytic converter. Damn, you ain't but had that car for a few months. My grandmother, 2 hours east, responded to the knowledge of the cataclysmic reports. Used car commercials and Wheel of Fortune reminders, splicing the background noise of evening news. As great-grandmother sat silently next to her. That summer, the season in which NPR published an article about Missourians making cicada ice cream, my car died. And I learned quickly that when classes aren't in session, when the spring semester ends and majority of the college students are gone, Columbia Transit doesn't operate. What is it they say? If life gives you a cicada invasion, make ice cream, but what do I do about an inadequate public transit system? You better get on a good foot, my sister advised, the two of us having filled the plate, having invested $1,000 of the $5,000 spent to buy the used vehicle. In Ferguson, there was a salesman named Majid who bragged about the Altima being a bit of a Frankenstein. An 05 body with an 06 grill and heart, both parts coming from an Altima that was totaled with fewer miles and sitting idly in a junkyard, portions being sold like black market organs. Sounds like magic, I said when he gave us his name. And by the time I drove off the lot, my auntie was telling everybody we passed. This my nephew. He in college and this his car. She directed my sister to get me something to ride to, and I was handed a few CDs. That was April, perhaps we were fooled, but that June, the billions of cicadas buzzed and buzzed, the males vibrating their timbals, flexing and mating and dying all over the place. As I walked the 6.4 miles to and from my apartment complex to work shifts at the downtown Papa John's, no, seriously, what do I do about an inadequate public transit system? My red polo and spare tank in my drawstring bag, the khaki Papa John's hat sloppy with sweat, emails to the city's Department of Transportation. You're welcome to voice your concern in person at our next city council meeting, a representative once responded. How the hell am I supposed to get there? My council responded. By July, long cicadas reigned in the Missouri heat. Shallow pools of them were at the base of trees and lined the sidewalks. I walked and they sang. I called Majid and he told me I most certainly had the wrong number. So this is the last poem I'm going to read. Kind of went by quickly. This is the last poem I'm going to read. Thank you again, Bernardo, Diannely, Ross, Taylor. I love all of you, all of your work. Very inspired just to be in conversation. Mavaka, thank you so much. And thank you for the listeners, the people in the audience. Of course, there's no indictment for Jason Stockley. Jason Stockley was is a police officer who was in St. Louis who killed someone and didn't get indicted. So you know how the story goes. Of course, there's no indictment for Jason Stockley. But my great-grandmother is resting. She looks regal in her Jerry chair, her one leg left propped like an antique. I don't know when her mouth began to part while sleeping, her remaining gold teeth tarnished, divvied across gums like dominoes. I have known the eyes to have always rested ajar. In the 90s, I slept parallel to her on a full-size mattress. We covered with one quilt and a thick comforter. We talked nightly news and prepared for my wedding the bed, an old ragged towel playing the role of a dam. I wore her t-shirts as nightgowns. Always in the late night was a scavenging and distributing of a soft 1X collectible. We talked until the Tonight Show with Jay Leno came on. Mostly, she fell asleep before me, her snoring light, graceful even. In the morning, I'd wake to a bed emptied of her, hers and her daughter's voice loud with merriment, then silence, and the smell of uncooked greens. The cracking of the stems picked apart, smoked ham hocks boiling, bubbling with anticipation, the TV faint. And suddenly, the women's voices came again. Like good girlfriends, they laughed a lengthy laugh. the kind of laugh that curled in the air, making others smile and to laugh. Laughter after gossip, laughter after grieving, laughter only those who have lived poor and Black and woman deserve to laugh. And the rustling of the trash bags as stem droppings fell between knees was as sporadic as the silences. For as long as I could, I managed to stay settled on the mattress, wet or dry. It was in my settling that I learned grown folks' business. The slightest move could alter a chronicle. If lucky, I learned of the South. I learned of the blues, its formulas for good loving, of how great grandmother grew up the youngest of eight on a Mississippi farm. I learned of her migration, how it was both escape and chicanery, how she migrated from one Jim Crow South only to make it to what might as well have been another. If lucky, I learned of the roots of her circumspection with white folks, openness always accompanied with hesitation or no openness at all. Then there was a shit talking, like how the white lady she pressed clothes for could kiss her Black ass first and ask questions later, and in the mix always an, ooh, girl, did you hear? These and other things were the makings of a survival. And yes, she is even teaching me survival now. Hoisted into confusion, her whole being in the hands of the Hoya lips. The Hoya lips in the hands of Black women who possibly live lives similar to the one she has. With patience, they convey her slowly to the rail bed, lay her softly on the mattress where she is always managing stillness, wet or dry. And she settles, her stump leaving space for me to sit centered. On the TV screen, there's a man who has killed a man. And through the pigeon we have created, I attempt to tap into her demented universe. I turn to her. I attempt to discuss the evening news. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you, L. Wow. Wow. I see you too. That was beautiful. Which is to say, because we work together, I know the revisions he's been. Wow, that was beautiful. That was really, really beautiful. Okay. Little palate cleanser. Next, in this cipher of writers, poets, thinkers, people I study with, practice with, we have my guy, Ross Gay. Now, I do want to say.
What do you want to say?
I do want to say. Everything you've heard about Ross. Fuck, it is true. It actually is true. But what you don't know is if you're doing kettlebells with him and your hand starts to rip, he might not care. If you're playing basketball with them and hit you in the forehead with an elbow, you still got to keep going. No. Again, Ross is, you know, someone that has been instrumental in my development as a person. Again, as a person. And if you can get somebody like that in your life, you really, you know, I feel blessed just listening, hearing not only Ross, but everyone here. But, you know, I mean, this has become kind of like, damn, I feel real blessed in my, and I'm really blessed to have Ross in my life. With no further ado, Ross Gay.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm glad to be with you all, and B, I'm glad that you invited me to join you all. It's just good to hear these poems and get kind of moved and removed by stuff. Yeah, it's so neat, because in a way, it's like we all get to watch each other just kind of like keep on learning how to do this stuff, and it's moving to me. So I'm working on this book. The title of this kind of gathered, what is it, the Radical Poetry Summit or other?
The Radical Poetry Reading, hosted by the Brooklyn Rail.
Yeah. I mean, I know it's about the Brooklyn Rail. But what I was going to say, because I needed to know that for what I'm going to say. So this is so radical, I'm going to read you some prose. And this is just, I'm working on this book, and ostensibly it's their essays in the midst of or in efforting toward, this is totally inadequate and inaccurate, but like a theory of joy. But joy is kind of somewhere in the question. And they have right now, these are probably gonna change, but they have all these things of like the, you know, it's joy and X, joy and Y, joy in skateboarding, joy in basketball, joy in blah, blah, blah. This one is joy and laughter. It's a longer essay. I'm just going to read the beginning of it, and then I'm going to read this joy and dancing. Joy and laughter. This might be an obvious one, or seem like it, but not to me. Because like every single thing, I was shown it by someone else. It was given to me. In this case, my beloved Dave, AKA Tornado, AKA Papa, who one day noted that sometimes when I get laughing, and Dave is the often origin of that laughter. I mean, my God, I love this guy. I hope you have a friend like Dave. He said, I looked like I was dying. I think he said it like this. Sometimes when you laugh, you look like you're dying. And then he imitated my dying. I mean, my dying with laughter, squinting hard and my mouth wrenched into a grimace and shaking my head no and my hand out in the air and often kind of falling off whatever it is I'm sitting on. A chair or bench, or in Dave's old house where I used to sleep over a lot, the couch, which I called the dream couch for how intense and marvelous my dreams on it were. He would fall off whatever he was sitting on, arm out, crawl a little bit on his hands and knees, and then collapse onto his stomach like a fish smiling, which would make me once again die with laughter. Although I think I've heard, for what it's worth, laughter is one of the ways certain creatures indicate peaceability. Like, you know, you can let your guard down. I have to tell you, these days, any theory, so-called scientific or not, that is premised upon the state of war or conflict as normative, I am suspicious of. Let's have some lemonade, et cetera. It is also one of the ways, in my experience anyway, we consider our dying. We laugh along with our dying. Or, as Dave puts it in a poem, laughter is our way of letting the universe know we agree with the passage of time. My sweet Aunt Butter, who is 94, please tell no one I told you that, and has COPD, and is, well, for the most part, when you are 94, you are usually dying a little bit more clearly than when you are, say, 24 or 47, laughed when we talked on the phone recently and told me I needed to get out there to see what it was like getting old like that, which a lot of my people do. I think she meant living long, yes, but she also meant dying long. Her whole generation of siblings is alive. The baby is 90, the eldest 98. though the generations below have not fared quite as well. My father died at 58 and his babyest brother at 35. A cousin my age gone, others of us younger is pretty banged up. Aunt Butter coughed, said, "I ain't shit," meaning I'm weak, I'm dying. Then she laughed, coughed a little more, then giggled and said, "You have to come see us, baby. This might be you." A couple nights ago, we were on the porch with some friends and a beloved community member's death came up. And after this and that, there was some joke and we were falling out of our chairs laughing. We were a fatherless choir on that porch, all of our dads dead, a couple of them gone in their 50s, a couple of them brutal, elongated, intubated, mechanized hospital deaths, and talking about them, yeah, the sad stuff. But we laughed so hard the squirrels ran off. I can't in good conscience write the stuff we, or maybe I, was saying. You would stop reading. You would think ill of me, though the intersection of death and sex, let's just say that. We got loud. We cried with laughter. Probably a few times we all looked to be dying. On and on like this. How often our recollections of our friend Don murdered includes laughter. My dead grandparents are very funny. My dead grandparents are very funny. When my papa was dying, he died a few years before his son, my dad, phew. He told the doctors he was 6 feet tall. Although after the approximately 1 million surgeries he'd had keeping his body just barely above ground, he was maybe 5'2". My mother's father, my grandpa, Virgil, ate cherries like a hyena, quoth his youngest, referring to the bloody juice running down his chin and chest. And that quoting youngest, well, how often does it occur to you that every goddamn buddy is dying? I'll pause that one there. And then this one is called Joy and Dancing. And again, yes, I'm glad to be reading with you all. It's just good to be in space with you. And thanks for having us and all of that. Joy and Dancing, this is, let's see, with, after, and for Patrick Rozelle. For the past 4 or 5 years, I've kept a post-it note stuck to a bookshelf next to my bed. This may be to be sure it leaks into my dreams, with the phrase written in all caps. Oh, hang on, let me do this again. For the past 4 or 5 years, I've kept a post-it note stuck to a bookshelf next to my bed. This may be to be sure it leaks into my dreams, with the phrase written in all caps, "We went free." It is a quotation, something my friend Patrick said in a conversation one day when we were talking about dancing. He was describing a recent night out in a crowd. Some time had elapsed, some warming up, some groove prepared. I think a particular song came on and then boom, something happened, which he described, like I said, "We went free." The actual second he said it, I smiled and shook my head no, and then shook my head yes, like this motherfucker, and scribbled on my hand and then in my notebook, which I shortly thereafter transcribed to the post-it note, which I have stuck here these years. And though I wasn't there, I have been there enough times to know exactly what he means when he says we went free, which can happen any number of ways, seems to me. For instance, right now, I can more or less guarantee you that if there were 15 or 20 people of my generation and perhaps a few other subject positiony things, if New Editions, If It Isn't Love, or Troops Spread My Wings, or A Tribe Called Quest Scenario, or any of another 500 or so songs, 1,000 of them incidentally by Prince, came over some cosmic speakers, we would, regardless of the setting, I'm telling you, whether it was in a yoga class or at a snoozy literary conference or at a stoplight or at a funeral, boom, we jump up and start dancing. Good chance someone, this is one of Pat's many callings, or several someones, when the song announced itself as those songs do, would yell some diphthongy vow to gather us up like, oh! And as though cinched together by an invisible force, we would, all together now, go free. It's not only, but often it's music pulls us out of our chairs like that, makes us push back from the table and say, damn, like that, or makes us circle up like that, or maybe make a line like that, or become a pit like that. I have often gone free in a fishbone mosh pit. Perhaps because music's primary characteristic, like our voices, possibly like our bodies, is that it disappears, which is not music's or our body's only characteristic, but a significant one, maybe the significant one, maybe the first one, though birth is the first thing that happens. It's back to Godot again, born astride a grave, here 1 second, gone the next. That's rhythm, by the way. The breaks in the silence, the breaks in the rest, the break from the grave, and no wonder it draws us up together to shake our asses or whatever on us shakes. Remade kin by the break, remade kin by what blooms us from the grave. It ain't nothing that dancing is sometimes called getting down. It ain't nothing that some of our best dancers, I mean our downest dancers, are also our oldest. And like Lorca reminds us, when they dance with the ants nipping at their heels, the roses throw petals into luminous carpets to our graves. In the midst of all this, you might be wondering, free from what? And rightfully so. For freedom, as it is conceived almost always, as far as I know, involves a disentangling or unburdening, free to be me, etc. National myths, Independence Days, for instance, often involve freeing oneself from the oppressive this or that. Never mind, the emancipated nation usually slides into the place of the oppressive this or that. Personal stories of freedom are likewise often about getting out from something's control. It's my prerogative. I can do what I want to do, etc. Or getting out of a terrible situation, that too. Spiritual freedom sometimes implies emancipation from the material realm or death, or the confines and burdens of the decaying body, though this gets hazy, given as the spirit can snatch you up to your feet, can take you over, not unlike what would happen, I'm telling you, if the first few notes of Lauryn Hill's cover of Roberta Flack's Killing Him Softly came over the cosmic speakers, or Jill Scott's Golden, or the first couple bars of Every Little Step, or either of the Joy and Pains. We would be snatched up to our feet. Yes, passive voice, thank you very much. It would be like that time I was in the waning hours of a dance party in a living room of a straw bale house with a bunch of Black farmers at Soul Fire Farm, and the first few notes of Kendrick Lamar's All Right came on, and my God, we went free. People threw their drinks down and sprinted close enough to each other that each other got murky. We became amoebic, hivish, murmurative, our breath and sweat commingled, and that woman from Germantown froze at that part of the song where Kendrick freezes, and in my head I was like, it was another necessary reminder, God damn, we're beautiful. 10 minutes later, breathing hard, we were out under a full moon, Whitney Houston was covering Dolly, I'll Always Love You, and we made like trees reaching into the air by reaching through the ground toward each other, by which I mean, at least for a little bit, we got free. All of which is to say, as I think I understand it, though for sure the free getting Pat was talking about could be a kind of escape or liberation from any number of things that keep us from dancing hard together. Police of every stripe, inside and out, whose job is mainly to quell precisely this. We went implies that the getting there, the escape or flight, is always together. There is no freedom, despite all that pervasive, ubiquitous, me against the world, safe-made bootstrap bullshit, absent we. Not some pipsqueak we either. The we born astride a grave, which is everything. With whom we belong when we dance like this, sweaty and funky and groany. And if your knee or your back or your hip hurts, or if the chair of your wheel squeaks, or you can't see, or your heart is broken in two, me too, me too. Let's let it be ours again. Oh, it means let's get up now. It means this is how we get down. Thank you.
Drumming my pain with his fingers, singing my life with his words, killing me softly with his song, killing me softly.
I think that's the biggest compliment. I'm not even gonna, that was the thank you. That was it. Woo, you know, I'm gonna take an audible, like, you know, that sometimes you they want you to do talks, but I feel like a talk might fuck this up. Like, we just, it just is in the air. It's all good. Malvika, thank you. Thank y'all for coming. Thank y'all for doing this with me, studying with me, practicing with me, being here with me. That's all I gotta say. Take us out.
Thank you.
Thanks y'all so much. Thank you, Diannely. Thank you, Taylor. Keep it running underneath. Thank you, Elle. Thank you so much, Ross. Thank you, Bernardo, for bringing us all together, for DJing, keeping us moving, keeping us thinking, pulling out all the choice lines and the morals and offering them up to us like little bites. Love what you said, that when we're reading, we're not just reading for the people sitting in the room, and also that the poems are the people. You know that I believe that. If you didn't, you know now. As always, we'll be sharing the recording of today's reading on our online archives as well as on YouTube, so it'll be available in a day or two if ever you'd like to revisit this magical space. I know I will, with the vegan hot dog in hand. And we do this every day here at The Rail, so please join us again tomorrow if you can, when we journey to Mildred's Lane, a 94-acre project site, artist residency, experimental community, and probably so many other things. Experiments in thinking, doing, making that takes place in the Pennsylvania woods on the upper Delaware River. We'll be joined tomorrow at 1 p.m. by co-founder of Mildred Lane, Mark Dion, ambassador of entanglement, J. Morgan Pewitt, David Brooks, curator and cultural historian, Alistair Gordon, writer Barbara Bourland, and tuning in from the woods alongside them is interviewer Thirza Nichols Goodeve. We'll close out with a poetry reading from my beloved friend, Patricia Huminek, whose name I always struggle with, and yet I will practice before tomorrow. And that will be, as always, at 1 p.m. Eastern, noon Central, right here in the Zoom. Other than that, thank you all so much. I'll invite you all to turn on your microphones if you'd like to say, I don't know, hello to one another, goodbye to one another, anything else that compels you. But this has been really, really special, really sweet, really solid Friday energy on this Wednesday. Thank you all so much.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bernardo.
Thank you.
That would be cool.
Be good. Love y'all.
All right, everyone stay in touch.
Bye.